to worship Him with all your heart and mind and soul. Amen. Like I said, I feel like I've just gone to church. I can go home now. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, when I was praying and worshiping, it came up on my heart. It was like, just you gave me confirmation. I was thinking, why do we come to church? Is it because we want to hear His word, we want to grow, or are we doing it because someone next to us? If that person is not next to us, then we don't come to church. Then you're not doing it for God, you're doing it for people. Like you just said, you gave me confirmation. I wasn't going to say anything about it, but it is so true. I come here because I need to be here for God. I come here because I want to be taught, I want to be grown, and I want the fellowship to edify me, to say, keep going, Lane. He's with you. Keep going, Kim. He's with you. Keep going, Shelby. He's with you. He's with you. Kevin, he's with you. Francine, Emma, he's with us. And all of us just keep going because he is who we want a relationship. I want to be here because of God, nobody else. If my wife don't show, I guarantee I'll be here. And if I'm not here, she will be here because she wants to be here like you to hear what God has to say. And I'm thankful, and I think we as people need to search our hearts to say, why am I coming here? Is it because of someone else, or is it because of God? And I believe it's because of God. You know, I was reading the other day and just being in my prayer time, and you know, you always get kind of that point of, Lord, what are you going to give me for the next Sunday? You know, you always say, okay, it's Wednesday, I need to hear from you. What do you want me to speak upon? Because, you know, I just have to ask you. Because he knows who's going to be here. I don't. He knows who needs to hear what I have to speak about because he puts it on my heart. And 90% of the time, it's always to me. I'm saying, Lord, I needed to hear that. Thank you. Because sometimes when you're preaching, you hear it different than when you're studying it. You know, it's like, oh, wow, Lord, I need to be there. So, you know, the title, if you like the title messages, I really don't, but it's submit yourself therefore to God if you want a title. Submit yourself therefore unto God. And when I was reading some verses, came across my mind, which we all know. It was in James chapter 4, verse 7 and verse 8. It says, the very verse 7 says, submit yourself therefore unto God. And resist the devil, and he will flee from you. And the next verse goes on to that. It says, draw nigh unto God, and God will draw nigh unto you. And I love how James finishes it. He says, hey, here's your responsibility is to draw nigh unto him, and he'll draw nigh unto you. Then look what he says. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Don't be double-minded with God. If God says it is truth, remember last week we said the truth will make you free. That's what I preached on. That the truth will make you free. His word is truth. Don't be double-minded about it. If he says it, it's going to come true. If he says it, it is true. We need to believe it with faith. So I was praying about this. I said, wow, everybody knows these verses. Well, if you read the verse above, it says, he resists the proud and he loves the humble. That is our first step as people is to become to him in the place of humility. And then submit yourself to him. And then draw nigh unto him. And then the devil will flee. Do you see how he put that together for us to understand? Submit yourself therefore to God. So I want to do a little teaching about James 4, 7, 4, 8. Because I think each one of us needs to hear We talk about our problems. We talk about our struggles. We talk about our temptations. We talk about our fallen. Father, why do I keep going through this? Why do I have anger? Why do I have this bad mouth? Or whatever it is that you're fighting. And here it is in Scripture. It's easier than we think. It really is, but the problem is us.
Like I was telling Kim this morning about this artist that my wife brought up. And she wanted to hear this song. And she says, do you know this guy's name?
And I go, oh, yeah, he was married for almost 30 or 20 years. And he had four children. And he's one of the biggest singers at one time, worship singer. There's many of songs out there. People are in every church is filled with his songs. And he desired to leave his wife and his children to marry a man. And leave everything. And in his testimonies, he's fought this ever since he was 9 years old. But he says, I fought it ever since I was 9 years old. I'm like, did you ever submit yourself to God? Did you ever resist the devil? Did you ever draw nigh unto God? Because his promise is if you resist the devil, he will flee. See, the problem is we're not resisting the devil, so he's not fleeing. And I'm going to get into that today. But what broke my heart, here's a man that was married, went to church, preached the gospel through his music to thousands and thousands. There's still many songs out there. And his songs were, one of them was my favorite song. And he woke up one morning and said, I'm going to leave. To fulfill the desires of my flesh and marry another man. That is an abomination unto God. He has sinned against Almighty. God has given him a talent and said, go out there and use the talent I give you. I gave you this gift, and you could not defeat the devil. It breaks my heart. We're seeing more and more of that coming into the church today. Sinners need to repent and get saved and turn to God and have a relationship. So my thought is this, how many of us have a relationship with Jesus? Is this a religious place that we just come to have donuts afterwards and fellowship? Or is something that Shelby said that was so true? I don't want to miss something that might help me with my walk during the week. I don't want to miss something. I want that relationship with Jesus because he's going to speak to me. That's the heart that I want to come to the doors. Lord, what do you have for me today? I don't care if there's one in here or if there's 100 in here. It doesn't matter. God has something to say and listen through his words. Amen? It's his words that sets us free. It's not blame. It's him. That's why I always pray, Lord, let me decrease. You increase. Let me get out of the way so you are the way. It's your way. It's your truth. It's your life. It's not about blame. It's about Jesus. He's the answer to all your problems is one name, and it's Jesus the Christ. If you call upon Yeshua or Yahushua, he will answer your prayers. He will deliver you. But you have to have faith that he can and he will. See, we have to get out of ourselves, get out of Egypt, and cross the flood. I mean, the big sea of your doubts. The sea of your unfaith and your unbelief and the seas of your problems. And get to the other side, and the other shore is Jesus. And when you say Jesus, everything flees. But you have to call upon him on that pure heart and that pure mind and that pure soul. And you have to be sold out to him, and you have to give your life to him. But a lot of times we don't want to give our lives to him because we might miss something in this world. But is there anything in this world you're taking with you? When we die, it stays. Have a heart for Christ. Give yourself to him with the completeness of who you are. The word that starts in the sentence of verse 4-7 is a word that we don't like to hear. It says submit. Submit. That means to obey. It's to submit means to obey. I know in Ephesians it says, wives, submit to your husbands. And husbands, you love your wife as Christ loved the church. That's a hard one to preach on because wives don't want to submit today in this world. And husbands don't want to love their wives as they love Christ. They want to go in their own ways. I'm my own man. I'm my own woman. No, you're not. I read this morning when Jesus says that you become one. There is no twain no more. There is no wife, no husband. You become one in Christ. Your focus should be on the same thing. It should be glorifying the Most High God. When the husband and wife in one relationship will glorify him, then you watch that house be moved with the peace of Christ, with the joy of Christ, with the love of Christ within your house. That's what it means to be in one flesh. That means you are in his body, and he dwells within you, and the Spirit of God dwells within you. Hallelujah. Submit means to obey. It means to be under obedience or to be obedient to him. Put under or subdue unto. Be made, subject. This is the actual Greek word. In subjection. Submit self unto. To submit to one's control. How many of you like to be submitted to someone under their control? That's what that word, when he says, submit yourself, therefore, unto God, we are to submit to him in everything. In everything. It means resist is the next word we'll be looking at. Resist comes from two Greek words. Stand and against. That's what that means. Stand and against, to resist. We're going to look at a couple of those two words. Submit and resist. That's the key to our walk. It's to submit, resist. Well, I'm having problems. Well, then submit and resist. It's simple as that. Don't make the gospel harder than what it is. The gospel is in the realm of simplicity. We don't want to make it super hard to understand. Well, I've got to walk 10 seats. I've got to memorize 100 verses. I've got to read three chapters today. Then I'm submitted. No, just give your life to him. Submit to him and say, you are the God of my life. You are the God. Help me to be obedient in all my walk, all my talk, all my actions. We fall short of that every day. Every day. But that's all right. Get up and submit again. Lord, forgive me. I messed up. I'm submitting my life to you again. You can read it through the Old Testament. When you submit, you're blessed. And when you don't resist, you're cursed. Read it. All the way up through all the kings and through all of Israel as it was a nation. When they submitted themselves to God and repented from the sin, they become a blessed place. When they turned to God, they become a cursed place. The walls were broken down, the enemy came in and destroyed, plumbed, took everything that they had. And guess what? Their stubbornness heart, they fought again, and then about 40 years later, that's what they do. Repent and submit it, and God comes back because of his love and grace and blesses them. He does the same to us. We just need to submit to him. Submit all your problems to him. Submit. That's why it says in there, in 1 Peter, it talks about, that's 5:7, cast your cares upon him because he cares for you. Cast your cares upon him. A lot of times we cast our cares upon everybody else but Christ. Isn't that true? We do. We need to love Jesus with all of us and all of our hearts and come together as one, as a family, and believe in prayer. We come against the sickness in this congregation. Too many people are sick. I pray that God touches them today and heals their body. And let them know that they have victory in Christ. Amen? Because we have victory in Christ. Stand upon the rock, not on the sand. I preach that in the name of Jesus Christ. Let it go forth. If we submit ourselves to the righteousness of God in the gospel, we shall begin to reverence and to admire and to obey the moral law that he has written within our hearts and minds. We shall be willing that God should reign over us and rule within us. We shall allow him to control us in body and in mind, in intellect and in consciousness, in heart and in will, in act and habit. We shall forsake our sins. We shall long and labor to be holy. Who wakes up in the morning and says, I want to long and labor to be holy? That is submitting yourself to God. Lord, help me to be holy today. Help me to control this mouth. Help me not to say the things. I was reading in Psalms 39, I believe verse 1. It says, take heed to your way. He says, I will take heed to my ways, that I sin not with my tongue. He says, I will put a bridle on my mouth while the wicked is before me. Do you hear me? When the wicked is before me, I will put a bridle on my mouth. I have failed in that more than once. And I just pray that God helps me with my tongue and with my mouth when the wicked is before me. Amen? So let's pray that today, that God help my tongue, help my words. In Romans 10:3, it says, for they, being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own righteousness, and have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. The thing that I'm seeing in the church today is their own righteousness. No matter what they bring from the pulpit, no matter what play they put out there, it is because of their own righteousness. If they would submit unto God's righteousness, we wouldn't have the filth in the church today. They call the body of Christ. They wouldn't bring in the filth. You wouldn't have two pastors up there, man and man, preaching the gospel if you would bring in the righteousness of God. You wouldn't have the filth that we have that is polluting America and then the ends of the world. We're allowing Satan to get his foot within the house of God because we allow him to come in and say, we need this entertainment. We need the joy of him in there. We need the world in here so we can preach to them. No, we need the world to stay out of the church, and we need to preach the gospel in the church and keep it preaching and do not sugarcoat his word. If God doesn't like it, you shouldn't like it. Can I get an amen on that? You know, it says there's six things that the Lord hates. The seventh is abomination. A proud look. A lying tongue. A lying tongue. Hands that shed innocent blood. Do we see that in America, any innocent blood being shed? 12-year-old girls, 13-year-old girls, 14-year-old girls not going to get an abortion. Our hands are shedding innocent blood in America. And you want to be a blessed nation. Submit yourself to God, America, churches out there. Turn from your wicked ways and turn back to him and watch what he does in the church. Watch how he will bless each individual that will submit themselves to him. Shedding innocent blood. It says also that a heart that devises wicked imaginations so rampant through the body of Christ, they call themselves Christian. The next one is feet that are swift to run to mischief. We see that all through America today. We see it in and out of the body. It's amazing. And false witnesses that speak lies. The last one is this. The abomination that God hates the morals is a brother or sister that will sow discord among the brothers. People that will sow discord among the house of God. If you preach his gospel, there's no discord because there is no confusion in God. These kids that are confused today is because they don't have God in their life, because the parents ain't preaching them the truth, because they don't want to offend them. Children, I'm not worried about offending you. You need to get right with God, too. You teenagers out there, submit yourself unto God. Oh, but it's not popular. Well, I'm not very popular either. I'd rather not be popular and go and spend eternity with Christ than be popular and spend it in hell. I'd rather not burn forever just because I wanted to be popular or it's not cool. Oh, but preaching the gospel, preaching death, preaching the burial, preaching the resurrection, preaching on hell, is it cool today? Well, I don't want to be cool. I want to preach the gospel. People need to hear about hell today because I don't care what they say. It's real. And there's people that's going to hell because the gospel's not going out. There's not evangelists like they used to be. There's not people caring about people's souls anymore. They just care about themselves and their own righteousness, is just what I read in Romans 10, 3. But when we submit to God and his righteousness, then you worry about all the souls, and you cry for the souls, and you pray God send laborers into that harvest, because it's plenty out there. It's plenty out there. We need to bring Christ to the lost. Amen.
Submitting ourselves to God, it leads to a lasting and unlimited submission. It's not just once and says, I submitted. It's a continuation. Every moment you get up, I submit myself to you today, Father. That should be in your prayer life starting today, or in the morning when you pray, or in the night when you get in your closet, the first thing that you say, Father, I submit myself to you. Let you reign within me. Not me reign within you.
Amen.
We must withstand Satan. If we yield a single step, a tie will instantly press his advantage. Did you hear what I'm saying? We must withstand the enemy. If you just give an inch, what's the old saying? We'll take a mile. There is no tie with him. He wins. Do you hear what I'm saying? There's no tie to say he won. You have to submit to God.
We must submit himself to God as the God of the gospel. That's who we submit to.
The God of the gospel, the good news, the death, the burial, and resurrection of Jesus the Christ. What Christ has done on that cross, what Christ has said, and what Christ has showed us through his gospel. That's who we submit to.
We must submit himself to God as the lawgiver. Thou shalt not lie, thou shalt not cheat,
thou shalt not commit adultery,
thou shalt love thy neighbor as yourself,
thou shalt put God first.
You shall love him with all of yourself, your mind, soul, spirit, and strength.
Everything you have, your first thing is to love him,
because you're submitting to him.
When you submit to him, you write his laws upon your heart. You know it's evil to cheat. You feel guilty when you lie. Well, I hope you do.
See a little bit of smiles out there.
We need to change our lifestyle.
Amen.
Man must submit himself to God as the God of prophecies.
Amen.
He must.
Resist the devil.
Resist the devil.
The foe, we call him.
His power can suggest ideas to the mind.
Inflame the evil desires of the soul.
We all been there with temptation.
We all understand what it's like to have that desire for something.
The guy I was speaking about, he said he had that desire since he was nine years old.
And then in his late 50s, early 50s, he fulfilled those desires.
Give them to God.
Submit yourself unto him.
His intelligence continually going about as a roaring lion.
If repulsed a hundred times, he tries again.
Listen, he's been around forever. He's not going to give in.
He's very wise and subtle.
He knows how to push your buttons, and he knows what your desires are.
And that's why it says submit yourself to God and resist him.
We need to resist him.
His malice, being the children of God, he envies all humans' happiness.
He envies us because we are created in God's image, therefore he hates us.
That's why it says he comes to kill and steal and destroy, because we're made in the likeness of God, and he despises each one of us.
But I guarantee he's trying to get you off the path. Even though you're the child of the Most High,
Even though you're covered with the blood and have the cloak of righteousness and you're called his son and daughter,
he is still in your ear.
He is still. That's why we have to put the full armor on. Amen?
That's why we have to resist the devil and he flees.
His experience has long studied human nature and practiced the art of deceiving mankind.
He started it in the garden.
Did God really say that? Is that what it's really saying?
If
if you're the Son of God, does he really mean that? He comes to deceive you. But when you're close to God, you draw nigh unto him, and God's nigh unto you, then you see what God sees through you, and that's his Son, Jesus. His policy is crafty, and his methods. He knows what he's doing because he hates you with a passion. And I guarantee you, every one of us in here, he has his ways to try to get you off the path, but we have a great God that will broaden our steps. Says the steps of the good man are ordered by the Lord. It says, hold my steps or enlarge my steps under me that my feet slip not. Do you see what the word says? Put them abroad, Father. Put them in your hands. Let me order them in your word. Now that's something we should think about. Order my steps according to thy word. What does his word say? I've hid it deep in my heart that I might not sin against you. That's what we do, is we take God's word, we hide it within our heart, we put it deep in us, so it will grow out of us. So when we're going to do that, the word comes to you, the Holy Spirit says, thou shalt not do that. Don't do that. Don't do that. Anybody ever heard the Spirit tell you, don't do that? And we still did it. We do. And then afterwards, how great do you feel afterwards? You ask forgiveness because you're a God. Just, man, Father, I messed up. Forgive me. If you're happy because you did it, then I, as a pastor, is wondering your relationship with Jesus. Do you hear what I'm saying? Closer you get to Christ, the farther you get away from sin. That's the truth. The fight for him is to resist, not to dispute. Don't argue with him. Even Michael the Archangel didn't even argue with him. He just said, in the name of the Lord, in the name of Jesus, he rebukes you. We're not there to dispute with the enemy. Do you hear what I'm saying? Don't dispute with him. Just say in the name of Jesus. Just be in the name of Jesus. The general orders is this. Be sober. Be alert. Be awake. Be sober. Physically, mentally, pride, anger, love of pleasure. Don't. Listen, the soul is for warfare. Don't have that pride. Don't have that anger. Don't have the love of pleasure. Keep your eyes on Christ. Number two, be diligent. His time is always ready. The enemy's always ready. The problem is sometimes we're not always ready. We're tired. We don't feel good. We're beaten down. Oh, Lord, I don't want to pray today. I don't feel good. Oh, I don't want to read the Bible today. I don't, you know. We get there. I'm just beat. It's because you're allowing the foe to beat you down. Get back up on your feet, man. You are a survivor because you stand in Christ. Christ didn't get defeated, no matter what they threw at him. Amen? No matter what they threw at him. Be united. There's the key word of the day, be united as a church in one accord, and watch what happens. Be united. Call in all your allies. Stand shoulder to shoulder and pray. We're all praying in church. We send it out when something happens. The whole church finds about it. We're all praying. We get up and we pray for each other in the morning. We're a praying church. That's what I'm talking. Stand shoulder to shoulder. And let's keep praying for each other. Let's keep lifting each other up. We're all fighting a battle, amen? Christ has already won. Try weapons. Here's your weapons. You want to know what your weapon is? The Word of God. There's your best weapon. Word of God. Past experience. Earnest prayer. The invincible armor is in 10 through 18, if you want to know your armor that you put on. It's a full body armor. From the helmet to a breastplate to a belt to shod it in your feet with the gospel. And guess what? You take up the shield of faith. That shield of faith quenches all the fiery darts of the enemy. That means we have to have that shield of faith because he's always throwing darts at us constantly, constantly. We need that shield of faith. And if you read the next verse, it says, take the helmet of salvation, which is the word of God. Did you hear me? Which is the word of God. We need to take that word of God and use it. And I will show you that here in a little bit. The flight. Not fight, but flight. This promise imports temporary flight in this life. He flees only to the rally his forces and returns. But constant resistance, while it strengthens the Christian, it weakens. If you continue, it weakens him. But he will come back. He will come back. But you know how to resist him. And guess what the Bible says? He will flee. And we'll see this in a little bit. In Psalms 32, verse 5 says, I acknowledge my sin unto thee, and my iniquities have I not hid. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord. And thou forgivest me of my iniquities, of my sin. When we get to there, we'll resist the devil. And we'll get closer to God. See, that's the beautifulness of him. Amen. The true method of doing this is by submitting ourselves in all things to God. While we yield to God in all things, you are to yield to the devil in none. We're not to yield to him. We must resist Satan, the devil, the head of the leader of fleshly lusts. He is the leader of the lust of the children today, if it's TikTok, or if it's this. They have that lust, that desire to be on there because they're going to miss something that they don't even know. They don't even know the people that's on there. But it has them so captured. A phone will blink, and then first thing they do is stop a conversation and go to their phone. We all do it. We've been caught so much in his web. That we forget our eyes will be on Christ. He takes care of our problems. Let's turn to Matthew chapter 4. Matthew chapter 4. I'm going to read a little bit here. It shows us how to resist the devil. Okay? I'm going to start in verse 3. But I'm going to get me a bottle of water before it. Thank you. I'm going to read, starting verse 3, it says, and when the tempter came to him, and he said, if thou be the Son of God, thank you. Since she's going back there, if thou be the Son of God, listen to the first thing he said to Jesus. If thou be the Son of God, he questions your relationship with God. If thou be the Son. If thou be the Son of God, command these stones to be made of bread. Listen how Jesus resisted them. He goes here. But he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by what? Every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Let's go to the next one. Then the devil didn't give up when he said that. Then the devil taketh him up into the holy seal and setteth him on the pinnacle of the temple. And he said unto him, if thou, here he goes, question him again. If thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down. Now watch what he does. Now he brings the word to him. Now Satan, a lot of people miss it. Now Satan's going to quote the word to him. He says, look at what he says. He says, listen to this. For it is written, he shall give in his angels charge concerning thee. And in their hands, he left some words out there. If you want to go read Psalm 91, you can find them. He goes, and in their hands shall bear thee up. Lest at any time thou shalt dash thy foot against the stone. Now the enemy's going to use the word of God against you. And he's doing this in all kinds of church. Talking about love over sin. You can be that lifestyle if you want to. You can do this because God is love. And if I love this, then God's okay with it. My Bible doesn't say that. If you truly read the word, it doesn't say that. God is love, but also God is judgment. Do you know that it says in Deuteronomy that all his ways are judgment? It's in Deuteronomy 32, verse 4. It says he is the rock. He is the rock. His work is perfect, but all of his ways are judgment. A God of truth and without iniquity, it says. He is a God of truth. All his ways are judgment. We will go someday to the presence of God. Not to be judged for our sins, but to be judged for our rewards. What have you done with my talent? I gave you a talent. What did you do with it? Did you hide it? Or did you produce with it? You hear what I'm saying today? That's what he did. But listen to this one. It says, for it is written again, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. That's what Jesus said. You shall not tempt him. Watch this. Did the devil give up? It says, and again, the devil taketh him up into the exceeding high mountain and shows him all, not some, but all the kingdoms of the world. In the glory of them, how he could be full of riches. You could be the king of all this, he's telling him. And he said unto him, all these things will I give thee, if thou wilt fall down and worship me. So we see that the enemy, Satan, wants worship. He wants to be a God because in his heart he says, I will be like God. He wants to worship a people. He wants to be like God, and he thinks he desires to worship. And he's telling Jesus, fall down before me and worship me, and I'll give you everything you desire. We have musicians out there that do that. We have people that give in there and sell their souls to God, I mean to Satan, and they're millionaires, and they have all the money they want, they have, and they're miserable people. They're miserable. And they just bought their ticket to hell. Repent and turn back to God and watch what he can do in your lives. And look at this. Verse 9, and he said unto him, all these things will I give to thee, if thou wilt fall down and worship me. Verse 10, then said Jesus unto him, get thee behind me, Satan, for it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. Look at the next verse. Then the devil leaveth him, and behold, the angels came and ministered him. Will we tell Satan to get behind us, because we're only serving one God? And then the angels came and ministered to him. How do you like that? Now let's jump over to Luke chapter 4. Same thing here. Same thing. I want you to get how important this is. Verse 1, it's interesting, it says, and Jesus, being full of the Holy Ghost, returned from Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. The Spirit led him into the wilderness. Sometimes we're in the wilderness, people. But my God is the God over the wilderness, as he is in the plains, as he is on the seas, and as he is on the top of the hill. My God is with us. Sometimes we go into the wilderness. In the wilderness, we need to resist the devil. Don't let him win when you're down. Don't let him win when you think you're drowning. Don't let him win. Resist him. Resist him. Read this thing. It's the same answers. It goes on. But I want to get to the last part of this, because it's the same words on the other one. It says in verse 12, 4:12, it says, and Jesus answered and said unto him, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. And when the devil had ended all the temptations, he departed for a season. Look at the next verse. And Jesus returned the power of the Spirit. He said he did it for a season. That means, guess what? Get behind me, Satan. He did it for a season. He's coming back. Jesus just showed us how to defeat the enemy by his word. By being submitted to God, no matter what is thrown in front of you. I guarantee you, in our lifetime, some have been around a lot longer than me. Some hasn't been around as long as me. But there has been temptation in our life that looks very good. And God is saying, no, that's not for you. we would have yielded to it, we wouldn't have the life we have right now. It might have been a better life on this world, but not for eternity. Submit yourself to God. That's amazing. As soon as Christ said, get thee behind me, Satan, so soon as we read, then the devil left him. We learn something. Use the name of Jesus. Get behind me, Satan, in the name of Jesus. When those temptations come, get behind me in the name of Jesus. Resist it. No matter how good it's going to taste or how bad, I guarantee you there's going to be trouble if you yield to it. Oh, I just do it this one time. It will mess up your life. Ask many pastors that today if they wish they could take back what they have felt they do. Just that one little time that they yield. They'd give everything to go back to that day and redo it again. I'm telling you, I was thinking this morning, the people that have died and gone to hell because they didn't want to give their life to Christ, if they had one more breath left, what would they say? What would they do after going down there and God said, I'm going to put you back in your body for one more minute? What do you think they would do? I believe they would scream, Jesus, I need you. Forgive me, for I'm a sinner. Because they have the reality of where they're going. People need to know where they're going without Jesus Christ to open their eyes. We need those old-time preachers back. Amen. We have to have them back. We're getting too soft. Too soft. There is no one who is saved. He does not yield. Satan will always be persistent to try to tempt you. I just want you to know that. You cannot conquer. He cannot conquer you if you continue to resist. Remember what Ephesians 4:27 says? Neither give place to the devil. The first part of that, it says, be angry and sin not. Then the second part says, neither give place to the devil. We are not to give him place. We're not to entertain him. We're not to give him even an inch. We're not even to give him anything. We're telling him to get behind us. That's what we're supposed to do. As children of the Most High God. We stand up against Satan, he will flee from us. The power of truth, the power of faith, the power of prayer will silence his artillery. It will silence everything he has against you if you stand up in that. What I just mentioned, the power of prayer, the power of truth, and the power of faith. That's what we have. We have such a great armor we could take, a great toolbox if you want to say. We have everything you need to stand against the devil. But a lot of times we don't use them. We want to say, I can do it. How many of you said in your life, oh, I can defeat this? Come on now. Then I go back to the verse above. God resists the proud and he loves the humble. When we go in a place of humility, we say, we can't do it. I need you, God. I cannot do this. I can't stop. I need your help. I'm submitting to you. Take it away. And then watch what God does. But within pride, within with full pride, I can fix this. I can do this. I can defeat it. How has that worked out for you guys? It hasn't. It hasn't, and it will not. The only thing that will work out is submit to the Most High God. Submit. Listen, worldly and fleshly lust stirs up the devil. It's stirred up by the devil. When you have that fleshly lust or any desires that's not of God, it's of the devil. Know your enemy. At that time, get behind me, Satan. Get behind me. When we stand up against Satan, he will flee from us. Remember that. Jesus Christ, Yeshua, he fled from the name and from his conquering blood. We have to remember it's the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, he will flee. There is no great temptation which may not be overcome with some small stone out of the brook of his holy scriptures. For it is written, For it is written. Why do you think we soak ourselves in his word? Why do you read every morning? To know more about the God you serve. And then do what Jesus says when you're being tempted. For it is written. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of God's mouth. Here's the words that proceedeth out of God's mouth. It's been written for us. Hallelujah. God has put it upon men full of the Holy Spirit to write down the scriptures. You don't believe me, go to 2 Peter, and it tells you that. It tells you about the scriptures. No prophecy is given by any interpretation of man. Prophecy didn't come in the old times by the will of men, but by holy men as they spoke by the Holy Ghost. They wrote it down when the Holy Spirit told them to write this down. We have all scriptures are inspired by God and profitable for everything from correction, for instruction, and for righteousness in our life. All scriptures have said, not one, all of them. I can't just read one chapter and say, hey, I don't need the rest. I can't throw the Old Testament away and say, oh, it's history. The Old Testament is all about Jesus Christ, from the very beginning, in the beginning, all the way to the very end. Amen. It's Jesus. You need to soak yourself in it. Amen. Remember, we have overcome. Remember, you were set free. Draw nigh unto God, and he will draw nigh unto you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Draw nigh unto God. If we wish God very near to us, we must seek to dwell very near to him. You know what only keeps us apart from God? You know what keeps us away from God? Sin. You want to get near to God, the closer you get to the light, the more darkness you see within you. And you see the filth. Like the song, everything in his light is shadows behind me. Closer you get to him, less you will have of the other stuff. We cannot really draw nigh to God, if we persist in hugging them, temptation, and all the faults of the world. Cleanse your hands, means of evil doings. Purify your hearts of evil thoughts. Matthew 11:29 says, my yoke is upon you, and learn from me, for I am meek and lowly in heart. Learn from me, I am humble. Just think, he could have zapped Satan. He could have made his own food. But no, he says, for his riddle, he was humble. We can learn a lot. Romans 14:11 says, for it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall confess me. Listen, there's going to be a day everybody's going to confess Jesus Christ. Hitler's going to have to say yes to Jesus the Christ. He's the Messiah, the Messiah. That's who he is. Every tongue will confess. Every knee will bow at his holiness and his greatness. Philippians 2:10 says the same, that the name of Jesus every knee shall bow, of the things in heaven, the things in earth, and the things that are under the earth. There is nothing left out. Nothing. Even this person right here is called Satan. He's going to bow. He's going to bow. He's going to bow. It says, and that every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God. We'll leave you with this. The devil may deceive us, but he could not deceive Christ. Christ saw that it was the devil, and he said in his last, get thee behind me, Satan. More of Christ and less of us. Get behind me. So I pray today as the word went forth that you learn what it is to submit yourself unto God and how to resist the devil. How to draw nigh to him, and remember, he said he will draw nigh to you. But you have to submit yourself unto him, and then resist the devil. Then draw nigh to him, and draw nigh to you. By cleansing your hands of the evil thoughts. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew the spirit within you today. Do that, Father, I pray, for each one of us. Each one of us touch us today and teach us how to get closer to you, no matter what you've thrown at us in, no matter how much mud, no matter what he says, no matter what he puts in front of you, no matter how beautiful it is or how it's going to taste. Remember, it's a lie from the pit. He did it to Eve. Did God really say that? Today, the enemy was, did God really say that? Well, I read the word of God, and yes, he really did say it. Submit to him. Did God really say that? Yes. He knows that you will be like him if you do this, so he'll put lies into you. Oh, you'll be a great this. I don't want to be great at nothing. I just want to preach his word. I don't want to be known above anybody else because I'm equal with everybody else because the blood covered us all. I'd rather be in a place like it said Jesus was in a lonely place at home than walk around and say, I'm the pastor that you need to bow down to me. No, you need to bow down to Jesus the Christ, not a man anywhere standing in any pulpit. He has sinned just as you have sinned. Remember, you only bow your knee to Jesus and him only. If they're not preaching this word and they're not preaching it in pureness, then I tell you to run from that church now. Get out of it. My question is, why are you going to it? Oh, my parents went here. My family goes here, and you're going for the wrong reason. You need to go to a place that is preaching the word. It might not be popular to have some man up here preaching the gospel without compromising it, but it's the truth. And sometimes the truth we need to hear. Not sometimes, all the time. Because what sets us free? What sets us free from the enemy? The truth. His word will set you free if you will soak yourself and believe what he has said. And you only know what he said by reading it. Look at it. A half hour every Sunday isn't going to feed you. If I would eat every Sunday, I would be thin. Right? I'm trying to make an example here. I need to eat God's word as much as I'm eating food, and I'll be fat upon him. Hallelujah. I leave you with that. Let's bow our heads.
Praise God.
Father, we love you so much. And I pray that that word goes forth. I know it's going to be heard not just here, but all over the place for all the people that will be listening to it tonight and tomorrow and the next day in this week as it goes through. But let that word pierce the hearts, Father, to change the individuals that need to hear what you have to say to them. Do not let the enemy get in there and try to destroy this or block it, Father. I pray in the name of Jesus it goes forth because you said your word will never go back forward. You also said you won't share your glory with no man. Father, I pray that you help us to be more humble as a body and lift us up as we go in your way today. In the higher ways and byways, as you send us forward to bring the gospel to the lost. And I pray that, Father, that we see the people when they're lost and have a desire to see them come to your Son, Jesus, the Christ. Help us to preach your gospel, Father. Help us to never compromise it, never to water it down, never to sugarcoat it. No matter if you're not popular, Father, help us not to care about the world. Help us to only be concerned what we're doing with you. I ask that in the name of Jesus Christ, and we all say, Amen. What a blessing it is to be in church today.